set out on a narrow way many years ago.
On November 5th, 2005, Brian and Annie Peight said I do to each other. For better or for worse, in sickness and in health. They were ready to start their new life together, and they wanted to start a family. However, all their plans changed on July 25th, 2006.
I don't remember working at all. I worked from 12 to 9. I don't remember any of that, and that's my last memory.
I remember driving to try and find him, and I remember talking to his mom and her saying, Annie, he probably just had a flat tire. And I was like, no, he didn't just have a flat tire. He would have called me. Or maybe he hit a deer. No, he didn't just hit a deer. Like, he would have called me.
Annie was right. Brian had been involved in an accident. A bad accident.
First we saw the cars as we flew overhead. And I think usually the first thing that goes through your mind is, holy cow. These cars are really, really smashed up. When we looked at Brian first in the ambulance, he matched his cars.
Of course, I was in charge and gotten the call that we had a bad trauma coming in, and I took him. I just remember him being extremely sick and critically injured, and got him from surgery and gave him multiple blood products. He was very unstable, hypotensive, and just feeling like he wasn't going to make it.
I remember thinking when I walked into the room in neuro, oh my God, this guy is so badly injured. They were getting ready to take him down to that angio lab because they thought that he was leaking somewhere.
Like, I remember walking into the ER and Brian's Uncle Keith standing there and embracing me, and I lost it.
Brian was flown to St. Anthony Medical Center, where he was medically induced in a coma for 6 weeks. He immediately had surgery to repair his ruptured bladder, severed liver, and ruptured diaphragm. His list of injuries wouldn't end there. He fractured his left femur, right posterior pelvic bone, left hip joint, right fibula, right ankle, and left heel.
He had a terrible, terrible group of injuries, an open pelvic fracture, a lacerated spleen. We rushed him to surgery and controlled the bleeding that we could as best we can.
And then with Dr. Byerly, I remember him coming into the waiting room. I mean, it was 2 o'clock in the morning, saying, you know, listing off all the things. I remember him saying, the next 24 hours are touch and go. The next 7 to 10 days are the most critical, I think he said. And we'll discuss anything after that. And it never really sank in to me, you know, what it was.
Dr. Byerly, he gave us the information, like, this is, you know, it was cut and dry, black and white. There was no ifs or anything like that with Dr. Byerly, which was nice because we never had a false hope of what was going to happen to Brian. You know, like, he gave it to us straight out. And, I mean, it hurt sometimes to hear that, but we always knew what was going to happen.
And quite frankly, all along, I think the thing that gave me some hope that he would survive was his young age.
We heard it's a good thing he's young for, well, we still hear it sometimes.
Yeah.
And it's kind of a running joke in the family and with the people, you know, at St. Anthony's and stuff that know Brian really well.
I know she got really tired of hearing people say it, but probably the first thing out of my mouth was, he's young, he's healthy, and he's strong, and he has that going for him.
Brian spent 8 weeks at St. Anthony.
We wanted to be back to those normal people that everybody thought we were when we got married, and not a wife with a husband who's really sick, more of a husband and wife who just got married.
Brian and Annie had their family's constant support, love, and prayers.
I just felt horrible for his poor family and all of them that were here for them to be going through. This was a healthy young man that was involved in a very serious accident.
I got to know his mom and dad and his wife, Annie. And they were all, I mean, it was very obvious that he was very loved. So it was just an emotional roller coaster for them all the time.
They knew that they could always find somebody out in that waiting room. So they would always come out when something changed or anything and let us know, you know, this is what's going on or whatever. And we pretty much had somebody, I think somebody was there every single night with Brian from the time of the accident till he got released.
I've never seen so much support from a nuclear family and then an extended family. And not only were they there all the time for Brian, but they were kind and considerate and helpful to the staff. Truly, they became like family while they were there, and I think we've been close since.
Lifeline was huge for us. Lifeline came up every single day, whether it was Jed and Steve or it was Julie. Those were the three Lifeline nurses that I think had a bigger impact. I mean, they all had an impact, but they were all, we got to know them on a personal basis. I mean, I think that's what kept us going.
I try to do it for every patient, but they did become special because he was so critical for so many days in a row. And I think that by our presence up there, I think it kept the family positive.
Because every single day, like, and not just once a day, I mean, it was the day shift and the night shift. At least one of those nurses would come up and see Brian, even just to pop in and say, hi, you know, how's today going, into the waiting room.
I think us working with the neuro nurses, I just think that they felt like it was a family. We were all working for Brian to get better.
As time progressed, when Brian was getting better and stuff, we got to know the nurses, and they began to know us on a personal level. They began to care about not only Brian, but care about us.
Physically caring for the patient, because he was intubated and sedated, and taking care of his physical needs, but meeting the emotional needs of the family. The staff got very attached to Brian and his family. We felt it was kind of a treat to be able to get to take care of him, especially as we were able to wake him up more, take him off the sedation, and we could kind of see his personality start to come out.
All the nurses were very good. They actually interacted with me, and not that I really say much or talk to them much, but they were very helpful, very nice. It was pretty neat. Mm-hmm. I know they didn't have to do that, but it kind of made my days go by better.
My most vibrant memories of him was when I came in, I was getting a report, I was going to get to take care of him, and we hadn't gotten to the respiratory portion of our part for the off-going nurse to tell me that they had reversed his trach, and I heard a voice coming from his room, and it scared the crap out of me because I thought that he had pulled his trach out. And it was just the most awesome thing to hear his voice.
I remember getting a phone call at work, and I thought it was a joke. And it was Trevor calling, and it was Brian on the phone. And it was the first time I talked to him in, I think it was like 7 weeks. And I got to hear his voice. And that was for Trevor to take time out of his day to call me and let Brian talk to me was more than it meant the world to me.
I talked to Brian briefly before we paralyzed him and intubated him. He was very concerned about dying, and that's usually a bad sign. We do believe in miracles happening, and I think Brian was one of those cases where not only us, well, what we did, not only his youth, his being in good health and his being strong, but however you believe it happens, some miracles happen too.
Oh, he's a miracle.
Just remembering where he was at that first day to where he is right now is just, it's truly a miracle.
I really feel like he was a miracle. We work, you know, God works through our hands, and ultimately, regardless what we do or don't do, the final result is up to him, and Brian is one of God's miracles.
And I don't think Amy knew it, but he had been working on walking. He was in his wheelchair, and they started to play their wedding song, and he got out of his wheelchair and walked over to her.
I'd like to have the time I lost and give it back to you. But you just smile and take my hand. You've been there, you understand. It's all part of a grander plan that is coming.
the beginning, and I don't know if it was because I just had these intentions that this is how our life was going to run, and, you know, we were going to get married, we were going to have kids, we were going to, you know, carry on with our lives, and I didn't realize that Brian was as bad as he was, and it took, I believe it was Dr. Norris, his orthopedic surgeon, saying, you do realize he about bled to death. And that was kind of the realization, like, oh my gosh, this is really bad.
I think the final realization that when I was doing physical therapy and I couldn't even walk like 10 steps, and I saw a kid about my same age who had lost both of his legs, and he was walking all around at about the same time. And I was like, that just crushed me. I was like, why is it taking me so long to recover?
I think it was almost a year later where I finally said, I can stop being the nurse for Brian and be Brian's wife and not take care of him as a patient and be his wife and be and get back on track to where we were right before the accident.
And he pretty clearly has recovered too. And he's gotten out with his life and hasn't let his accident dominate his life, and it's very rewarding to see someone who does that.
The miracles continued for Brian and Annie on October 17th, 2009, when their daughter, Avery Evelyn Peight, was born. Brian and Annie love being parents. They enjoy watching Avery grow, learn, and play every day.
She's a miracle itself because Brian has so many injuries in his abdominal and pelvic region. You know, whether or not they'd ever be able to have children was questionable.
With Avery's first birthday approaching, Brian and Annie feel truly blessed every day for the miracles in their life, and they know that these miracles would not be possible without the hard work and dedication of many people.
Now I'm just a rolling home.